Hello and welcome to GST Ki Masterclass. Today is the second GST Masterclass in English and the fifth in the series of masterclasses that have been held so far. Our subject today will be of particular interest to traders, manufacturers, tax practitioners, chartered accountants, as well as journalists, as always. And our subject today is transition and invoice making. We are live on Doordarshan Network, and you can also watch us live on various social media handles of PIB India. That is on YouTube as well as on Facebook. You can also watch this live webcast on PIB's website, which is pib.nic.in. On this subject, transition and invoice making, we have received a lot of questions on social media, and the most frequently asked questions have been slotted for today's session on the basis of relevance. Answering them will be Senior Finance Ministry of officials. We also have representation from the government of Karnataka as well. And let me introduce them to you. We are joined by Hasmukh Adhia, Revenue Secretary. Upendra Gupta, GST Policy Commissioner, CBEC. And I'm also pleased to introduce Ritwik Pandey, Commissioner, Commercial Taxes, Government of Karnataka. So I'll tell you a little about the format of today's session. There will be opening remarks by the Revenue Secretary, followed by a presentation by Upendra Gupta, and that will be followed by the FOQs being answered by the officials present here. And after that, we'll open the floor for questions. So let's begin with opening remarks by the Revenue Secretary.
Thank you very much. Today is the second class on GST. The subject today is transition and invoice-related rules. The people are now transiting from the old system of VAT, excise, duty, and service tax into the GST regime. And there is a lot of stock which is available with people on 30th of June. So the questions arise in the mind of people as to how they are going to avail of the input tax credit on the goods which are held in stock as on 1st of July. So the transition rules refer to this particular matter. So today in our presentation, we would be explaining under what circumstances and to what kind of people this kind of a input tax credit is available. So we will talk in detail about it. The second subject is about the invoice. Now, a lot of people have got doubts about what kind of an invoice book should I make, what kind of details should the invoice contain, and who all are supposed to maintain the invoice book, etc. So all these questions will be answered in the presentation relating to invoice. So today I'm glad to say that apart from the central government team which has been taking the master class, today we also have the presence of Mr. Ritwik Pandey, who is the in fact, now he has just been switched to the Secretary Budget in the Department of Finance in the Government of Karnataka. So he is also here today. He had come for one of our law committee meetings, so I requested him. He will also be here to answer your questions. So we start with the presentation. I'll request my colleague Upendra to kindly make a presentation.
Thank you, sir. Like Revenue Secretary has mentioned, today's topic are twofold. One is transition and second in invoice. So in transition, because we'll not talk about the migration of taxpayers, which has been covered yesterday. So primarily I'll focus on the transition of input tax credit, which is available today, and how and under what circumstances it will be transferred to the new registration, which would be there in GST regime. So the presentation, the format of the presentation is like this, that what are the situations and how the tax credits would be transited. The first situation is that I am registered today in the central excise or VAT or service tax. How do I get ITC on 1st of July? So if you are already registered, you will file the return for the month of June 2017 or maybe for the quarter 2017, and there would be some closing balance in the return of related to SANVET credit in case of central government and ITC as it is called in case of state governments. So the entire closing balance which is reflected in the return as on 30th June 2017, that will be transferred as the CGST credit, the credit relating to central excise and service tax, and the credit relating to VAT would be transited as SGST credit. The conditions for that is you must have filed your return, last six returns, that is for the period from January to June 2017, you should have submitted your return. You should be registered as a normal taxpayer in GST regime. So if you take a registration as a composition taxpayer, then obviously you are not entitled for input tax credit, and therefore the closing balance which is reflected in the return as on 30th June will not be transited. The other condition is that the credit should be admissible as input tax credit. There may be some credits which were available in the pre-GST regime, but on certain items it may not be allowed in GST regime. In such a situation, to that extent, although there would be closing balance, but the credit will not transit. To avail the credit, you have to just submit a declaration in Table 5 of GST Trans 1, which is part of the CGST rules and the SGST rules notified with effect from 1st of July. And that declaration can be filed by 30th September. Within 3 months, it is to be filed. The commissioner has power to extend this for further 3 months, and it can be filed any number of times because there may arise some situation where the return is revised. In such a situation, the trans one, the table 5 of trans 1, the information contained therein is also to be revised. One important thing, the point which I was making, is the credit should be admissible as ITC in GST. The example would be the cesses. The credit of cess is allowed today in central excise and service tax, Krishi Kalyan cess, or the Swachh Bharat cess, but it is not there in the GST regime. So that credit may be reflected in the return, but will not be migrated, will not be transited. The second situation is with respect to capital goods. The capital goods, as you are aware, the credit is admissible in two installments. In most of the states also, it is similar situation. So therefore, the return would carry forward the balance only to the extent of 50%. The remaining 50%, which is not reflected in the return, the law and the rules provide that the remaining amount would be transited to the GST regime as CGST or SGST credit. And the information is required to be filed in Table 6 of GST Trans 1, again up to 30th September. And there, the details of every item of capital goods will be transferred. Again, I am making very clear that no permission is required for this transition. It is just a submission of information in the form of a declaration. The credits would be automatically, you will be eligible to take in your electronic credit ledger. The next situation would be if I am unregistered today, but I become registered in GST regime, then what happens? So if I am unregistered, I do not get any input tax credit today, but if I get registered in GST regime, then I would be eligible for input tax credit. The law and the rules provide that you will be eligible for the credits in respect of inputs held in stock and the inputs contained in semi-finished or finished goods held in stock as on 30th June. And to that, if you have duty-paying document, then only you will get the credit. There are certain conditions which I will take in the two, three slides later, because the conditions for the three situations which I am talking are same. So in this situation, you will get the credit of duty paid on inputs which are lying as such, or the inputs which are contained in the semi-finished or finished goods, you will be entitled for taking the credit. The next situation is that I am registered as composition taxpayer in the GST, in the current regime, and I am getting registered as a normal taxpayer in GST regime. In that situation also, because you are not entitled for credit today, but in GST regime you will be entitled for credit, so therefore same condition, that you will be eligible for input tax credit in respect of tax paid on input held in stock and the inputs contained in semi-finished or finished goods held in stock as on 30th June. The next situation is that I was exempt today, or I was dealing in exempted and dutiable goods both. So can I take the credit when my entire goods in which I deal will be taxable in GST regime? So in this situation also, the same principle will apply. The credits which is there in respect of dutiable goods, you would have filed the return and you will get the credit. And that situation is the number one situation which we had talked earlier. In respect of goods which were exempt and which are now becoming taxable, and therefore you will be liable to pay GST after when you make clearances or when you supply after 1st of July, the same principle will apply, that you will get the input tax credit in respect of inputs held in stock as such and the inputs contained in semi-finished goods. So these three situations, I was not registered, I was registered as composition taxpayer, I was dealing both in dutiable and exempted goods, and the alike situation is that I was registered as a first stage dealer or I was registered as a second stage dealer in a concept which is known in central excise, or I was registered as importer, or I was registered as a depot of a manufacturer, or I was supplying works contract services, but I was availing the benefit of notification number 26 of 2012 under service tax. So in all these situations together, you will get the credits of inputs and held in stock and inputs contained in semi-finished or finished goods. The important thing which is to be noted is that you will not get the credit of input services, nor you will get credit of capital goods. Now the conditions under which the credits would be admissible are like this. Next slide, please. That the inputs or goods which are lying with you, on which you intend to take the credit, should be used for making taxable supplies in GST regime. That is one condition which is to be satisfied. Then all those goods or all those inputs or goods which are on which you want to take the credit, they should be eligible for availing the input tax credit under the GST regime. If some of the goods are not entitled, then you will not get the credit. The third condition is that you must possess the duty paying documents evidencing that the duty has been paid on that. The fourth condition is that the invoice should not be more than 1 year old. So therefore, if the invoice is older to 30th June 2016, you will not be entitled to the credit. The fourth situation is that you have to just submit a declaration in Table 7 of Trans 1 up to 30th September, or it can be revised. So all these conditions have to be satisfied and you will get the credit in respect of inputs as such or inputs contained in semi-finished or finished goods. Coming to the next situation, that I am a trader and therefore I was not registered under central excise or service tax, but I was registered under VAT. So what happens? Obviously, I do not have the duty paying documents evidencing the payment of central excise duty. So what happens in that situation? Because now I will be liable to pay CGST also on my supplies made after 1st of July. But the central excise duty is part and parcel of the value of goods which is lying with me. So in that situation, the credits, whether the credit would be admissible? The answer is yes, you will get the credit. If you have duty paying documents evidencing the central excise duty payment, you will get full credit. But if you don't have duty paying documents, in that situation, what happens? The rules, section rule 117 provides that you will get deemed credit at the rate of 60% or 40%, as the case may be. The 60% credit would be admissible if the rate of tax on the goods which you will supply is 18% or 28%, and if the rate of tax is 5 or 12, when I say 5 or 12, it is combined rate, 2.5% CGST, 2.5% SGST. So if the combined rate is 5 or 12, then you get 40% credit. So, and the credit would be given when you make the supply. So for example, if the supply is made in the month of August, let us say, and then the August return would be filed on 20th September. On 20th September, you will pay CGST of 2.5%. So 40% of 2.5% would be credited to your electronic credit ledger on 20th September. This is how the scheme would be operated. The scheme is there for a period of 6 months. So all this stock must be cleared before the end of the calendar year, that is 31st December, and you will get deemed credit. The condition is that you must have the documents for procurement of goods, because even if you were a dealer, you were entitled for VAT credit, and therefore the VAT document must be available with you to show that you have procured the goods. The next condition is that the goods should not have been unconditionally exempt. The meaning of this is that, for example, if you are buying the goods from SSI unit today, or if you have bought these goods from a unit located in, let us say, Baddi or Uttaranchal, where the area-based schemes are operating. So even then, even though no duty was paid, but if you are buying goods from such entities, because these goods were not unconditionally exempt, you will be entitled for this deemed credit scheme. The condition is that the ITC which is allowed to you should the benefit thereof should be passed on to the consumer. You will get this credit, 40% or 60%, but you will charge the tax. Now you can't charge full tax from the customer and yet avail the input tax credit. So that care has to be taken. For this, a declaration in form TRAN 2 is to be submitted at the end of every month. It is unlike TRAN 1, which was to be filed by 30th September. This is to be filed by end of every month. And as I said, this scheme is for 6 months. One other scheme which we have introduced by amending the SANVAT credit rules. We have issued a notification, and notification number being 21 of 2017. It is a central excise non-tariff notification. It was issued and it has brought in a concept of what is called credit transfer document, CTD. It is specifically meant for the traders because they do not have any duty paying documents, and we are able to provide the benefit of deemed credit. So for certain high value items, and the scheme is like this. The CTD provides that if the value of the individual item is more than 25,000 rupees per piece, if they are identifiable by a distinct number, and if we have verifiable records of clearances and the duty payment related to each piece, then the trader, the one who is having the stock of such items, can request the manufacturer of such item, of those items, to issue a credit transfer document within a period of 45 days. That means from 1st July to 15th August, this request can be made by the trader to the manufacturer, and he would issue a CTD, and he will declare this information in trans 3. And if you have got this document, then you will get full credit of the duty paid by the manufacturer. So no deemed business. The only limitation which has been put is that in respect of entire stock available with you, either you will avail this CTD procedure, or you will follow the deemed credit procedure. You can't have mix and match. So either you follow this and you get full credit, because you don't have duty paying document. This is a fresh document, the scheme for which has been declared on 30th June by this notification number 21 of 17 under central excise non-tariff notification. So the trader also gets full credit if he has duty paying documents. If he doesn't have duty paying documents, if he has CTD, then he gets full. Otherwise, he gets deemed credit. The next situation is that I was registered under VAT, so do I get the credit of CST, the central sales tax? Today also the central sales tax credit is not admissible, so therefore the law and rules provide that you will not get the CST credits. But against the C form, F form, etc., the ITC will not be allowed to be carried forward. But when you submit the C form, the surplus credit on account of interstate sale or on account of export sale, the surplus credit which is lying with the VAT dealer will not be allowed to be carried forward. But on submission of these forms, the refund would be permitted after the forms are submitted. The next situation is that I am an input service distributor registered today, but I was not able to distribute the input tax credit because I have received the invoices on which I have to distribute the credit after 1st July. So the law and rules provides that the input service distributor will obtain a fresh registration under GST regime, but they would be allowed to distribute the credit in respect of services which were received prior to 1st July, but the invoices of which has been received on or after 1st July. So there would not be any denial of credit because the invoices were not available before 30th June. The next situation is that in service tax, as you are aware, today we have a provision of centralized registration. In GST, the service provider have to have state-wise registration. So they will be migrated from a centralized registration to state-wise registration. But today the credits is there only in one place. If some service providers is registered, let us say in Maharashtra, and now they are obtaining registration in 5 states because they are providing services from 5 other states also, then the credit would get transferred under first situation because this person would be filing the return and the closing balance of the return would be transferred to the registration in Maharashtra. So can he distribute this credit to other 5 registrations? That was the issue, because the earlier he was paying tax from one place and he was taking credit also in one place, but now he will make supplies from 5 places and he will also require the credits transfers from 5 places, and because he will use that credit for payment of service tax after he makes the supplies, payment of GST after he makes the supplies. So the law and rules provide that you will be eligible to transfer the credits as you want. So you can transfer the credits which is there in Maharashtra to all 5 states in whatever ratio you want. The only requirement is that you will submit this information in Table 8 of Form 10-1. The next situation is, which agitates the mind of the people, is that my appeal is pending, my revisionary proceedings are pending, my refunds are pending in pre-GST regime relating to send VAT or relating to any demand. What happens to those situations? What happens when I get some relief in appeal or revision proceedings? So the law and rules provides that you will be eligible to get the refund if you get favorable order in appeal on revision procedures, or your refund application get decided after 1st July. The relaxation which has been provided in the law and rules is that today you do not get refund in cash, but in GST regime you will get the refund in cash, because otherwise if we transfer then it would have wasted. So we will allow you the refunds in cash. Although the principle of unjust enrichment, which is applicable even today and which has been provided in GST regime also, that principle would be applied. As far as recovery is concerned, if some demand has arisen for pre-GST period or some appeal has gone against the taxpayer in post-GST period, then the law provides that the recovery would be made first under the existing law, under the savings provisions, repeal and saving provisions. And if we are not able to recover in the pre-GST under the existing law, then the recovery would happen as per the provisions of the GST law. The next situation is that I have entered into a contract before 1st July, but supply has been received or made after 1st July. What happens? Which tax is to be charged? So the law provides that in such situation, because it has happened, the supply has happened afterwards, or supply has, in such a situation, GST would be leviable, although the contract was entered into before 1st July. So this completes first part of the presentation relating to transitional provisions. Now I will move to the tax invoice provisions. So the tax invoice provisions, the first slide is who can raise invoice. The tax invoice can be raised only by a registered person, and he can issue the invoice in 2 situations. If he is making a supply of taxable goods or services, then he must issue a taxable invoice. Or if he is receiving taxable goods or services from an unregistered person, then also he must be issuing the tax invoice. There are some exceptions as far as first situation is concerned, where he's supplying the goods, taxable goods or services. The law and rules provides that if the value of supply is up to 200 rupees, in such a situation, and the supply is to a consumer, so meaning thereby it is not a B2B supply, the recipient doesn't insist for issuance of invoice. In such a situation, the registered person may not issue the invoice if the value is up to 200 rupees, subject to the condition that he will issue a consolidated invoice at the end of the day. So this will help the smaller taxpayers supplying smaller value goods or services. So in such situation, only a consolidated invoice will be issued. As far as the reverse charge situations are concerned, a registered person receiving taxable goods or services from a registered person, meaning where section 9 subsection 3 is applicable, in such a situation the registered person is not required to issue any invoice. But if he is receiving goods or services from an unregistered person, that is where the section 9(4) is applicable, in such situation, at the time of receipt of goods or services, the registered person is required to issue an invoice. But here also we have provided some exception to provide relief to the large number of taxpayers. What has been provided is that if you receive goods or services from an unregistered person of a value up to 5,000 rupees per day from one or more suppliers, if the value is up to 5,000 rupees, we have given exemption from applicability of 9(4). No GST to be paid and therefore no invoice is to be raised. But if the value someday is more than 5,000 rupees, then at the end of day, at the end of the month, you will consolidate all such purchases in one invoice, and at the last day of the month, you will issue one invoice to record all such receipts, value of which is more than this amount which I have just mentioned, where the reverse charge GST is to be paid on reverse charge basis. Now, what are the important contents of tax invoice? The important contents are that the GSTN of the supplier should be there, the consecutive serial number should be there, the date of issue of invoice should be there. If the recipient is registered, his GSTN should be mentioned. If he is not registered, then the name and address of the recipient should be there. HSN code should be there. HSN code, which digits? I will just come to that point a little later. Description of goods or services should be there. In case of goods, the quantity should be mentioned. The total value of the supply should be mentioned. Then the taxable value of the supply should be mentioned in the invoice. The tax rate, what is the central tax rate, what is the state tax rate, what is the integrated tax rate, and what is the cess. As you are aware, the tax is either central tax plus state tax, or central tax plus union territory tax, or integrated tax. So these are mutually exclusive. So the tax rates would be mentioned, the amount of tax charge of central tax and state tax or union territory tax, as the case may be, has to be there. The place of supply has to be mentioned. The address of delivery, if it is different than the place of supply, it should be mentioned. If the tax is payable on reverse charge basis, it should be mentioned, meaning thereby the contents on the invoice, whether you are receiving as supplier or whether you are issuing the invoice as recipient, are same. The only difference is this information, that tax is to be payable on reverse charge basis. And the signature of authorized signatory should be there. There is a lot of misgivings about this, that the invoice has to be digitally signed. I am making it clear that there is no requirement of any digital signatures on the invoice. It can be issued by manual signatures also. Another misgiving, that I must issue the invoice only electronically, that is also not clear. The invoice can be issued manually also. Once the GSTR1 procedure, etc., would come, not all the details are required to be uploaded, only few specified details would be required to be uploaded. And that can be done from a manual invoice also. No electronic invoice is required. Another message which is going around in social media is, that if you are buying from big shopping malls, etc., then you get the invoice split in various values. So if you get the invoice up to 1,000, the tax rate is zero. If it is up to 1,500, it is 2.5% and so on. It is only a rumor. There is no such provision in the law. Whatever value of goods or services you procure, the tax rates are only four. 5%, 12%, 18%, 28%. In some cases, cess is there, and in reality, there is some other rate. So it is all rumor. We should not go by this rumors. The important thing is that the same rules, the same contents are applicable in case of bill of supply also, in case of debit note also, and in case of credit note also, wherever it is required. So invoice would look like something like this, the portion which I have been rounded, these are the important things which I have just mentioned. The next issue is that at what level the HSN codes are to be mentioned. We have issued notification number 12 of 2017, and it clearly says that if your aggregate turnover in the preceding financial year was up to 1.5 crores, no HSN code is required. If the turnover is between 1.5 crores to 5 crores, the two-digit HSN code is to be given. And if it is more than 5 crores, it is four-digit. Trader should not worry on this account because they are procuring the goods either from manufacturer or the importer, and on both these documents the HSN codes are already there. How to raise an invoice? In case of supply of goods, the invoice is to be raised in triplicate. Original is meant for the recipient, the buyer. The duplicate is to be given to the transporter, and the triplicate copy is for the supplier. In case of services, it is to be issued in duplicate. Original is for recipient and duplicate is for the supplier. The only requirement in the return rule is that the serial number of the invoice issued during the month from this invoice to this invoice is to be mentioned in GSTR1, which, as you are aware, the procedure has been suspended for 2 months. How to raise an invoice? When to raise an invoice? So if you are supplying goods, so if the goods involve movement of goods, the invoice is to be issued at the time of removal of goods. If the supply doesn't involve movement of goods, then when you are making delivery to your customer, at that time invoice is to be issued. If the goods have been supplied on sale or return basis, in that case, you will issue the invoice either when the supply materializes, that means the consumer confirms that I have bought the goods, or 6 months from the date of removal, whichever is earlier. In case of services, the invoice is to be issued like presently, the provisions which are there in service tax law, that the invoice will be issued within 30 days of the supply of services. And in case of certain sectors like insurance and banking, it would be issued in 45 days. There are certain special cases which have been provided. So bill of supply. When bill of supply can be issued? If you are supplying exempted goods, a bill of supply is to be issued and not a tax invoice. If you are under composition levy, again you can't issue a tax invoice, you will issue a bill of supply. There is a provision of revised invoice. The revised invoice will be issued against a bill of supply, and this will be issued in those cases where the bill of supply was issued between the period from the effective date of registration till the issuance of registration. For example, for applying registration, you have 30 days to apply. So you have applied for registration on 1st July. You have got registration, let us say, on 10th. But it is effective from 1st of July. So during these 10 days, you must have supplied the goods. You would have issued bill of supply because you can't issue tax invoice. So for these 10 days, whatever clearances has been made, you will issue a revised invoice, which will be a tax invoice. The receipt voucher is to be issued if you are receiving advance payments. And the refund voucher is to be issued in cases the advance payment was received, but no supply could be made and the advance was received, was returned. In that case, the refund voucher will be issued. Certain more special cases are ISD invoice. Input service distributor has to issue a ISD invoice. So particulars which are there in the invoice are mentioned specifically. The other documents, in case of insurance, in case of banking company, in case of transporter, in case of airlines, they generally don't issue invoice. Today also they don't issue invoice. So for example, in insurance company, the policy itself will be treated as invoice. In case of a banking company, the bank statement itself will be treated as invoice. In case of airlines, the air ticket itself would be treated as invoice. And in case of transporter, the consignment note will be treated as invoice. So they will not be required to issue invoices. Another thing which I must mention is that there is no format of invoice. Only the particulars which should be contained in invoice should be there, and no format has been prescribed. Then in certain cases, because you can't issue invoices, a delivery challan is to be issued, and once the supply gets confirmed, the invoice will be issued. They are generally, the delivery challan is generally issued in case of liquid gases, in case of job work, in case of SKD and CKD supplies. In case of export invoice, the invoice format, the particulars of invoice are similar, what is there in case of normal supplies, but it must contain an endorsement that the supply is meant for export on payment of integrated tax or under bond or letter of undertaking without payment of IGST. Then credit notes. When can be credit notes be issued? The tax invoice has already been raised. The credit note will be required to be issued when you find that the taxable value or the tax charge in the tax invoice was more than what I should have charged, or when the goods are returned, or when the goods or services which I have supplied are deficient in nature. In all such situations, the credit note can be issued by the supplier to the recipient. The important thing to note is that he can issue a credit note anytime. But to reduce his liability, because the credit note will have the effect of reduction in the output liability of the supplier, that would be allowed only if two conditions are satisfied, namely the credit note has been issued up to September of the next year. For example, we are in 17-18, so before September 18, the credit note must be issued, and the second condition is September 18 or annual return, whichever is earlier. Annual return date is up to 31st December. So generally, up to before 30th September, it should be there. And the second condition is that the recipient should reduce his input tax credit, which he has availed on the tax invoice. And the last issue is debit note. The debit note is issued when the taxable value or the tax charge is found to be less than what should have been charged. In that case, debit note can be issued, and there is no such restriction in case of debit note. So all these documents are available on our website. The URL is mentioned. Just one second. The URLs are mentioned like this, cbec.gov.in, cbec-gst.gov.in. All these materials are available on our website. You can go through, and there are a number of other material also available on this website. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gupta, for the presentation. Let's take the most frequently asked questions on the subject of transition first. The first question is, I am a registered person under existing laws. How do I register in GST? This was answered yesterday, so we'll skip it. Second question, I was registered and providing unconditionally exempted, example, textiles supplies under existing laws. Will I get ITC if I register in GST?
With respect to unconditionally exempt commodities are concerned, because no tax has been paid on that commodity itself, there is no credit available. So therefore there is no ITC available during the transition also.
I was registered and providing supplies under existing laws, but was availing SSI exemption. Will I get ITC if I register in GST? That also, I think, has been answered, that if you are in SSI exemption, then you were not registered. Okay. I was registered in providing job work services under existing laws. Will I get ITC if I register normally in GST?
Here also, he will be registered as a service provider under GST. And suppose I have certain inputs lying, say for example, if I'm doing paint job work, then I have certain inputs in form of paints, and therefore I'll get the credit of the tax paid on those goods. There are conditions, as Upinder has just pointed out, that it should not have been purchased before 1 year from the transition date and all.
I was registered and my inputs were sent for job work before 1st July 2017, but not returned. What will be the treatment in GST?
In this situation, the law provides that if the goods are returned within 6 months, then no GST would be payable. But if the goods are not returned by the job worker to the principal, in such a situation, the input tax credit which was availed by the principal because he has not reversed the credit while sending the goods to the job worker. That will have to be reversed by the principal. The other condition is that both the principal and the job worker should have declared on 1st July that these are the principal would declare that this is the quantity lying with the job worker, and job worker would decide that this is the quantity in respect of the one or more principals was lying with him. That declaration submitted, then these conditions would be satisfied.
I sold goods and invoices were raised with TDS requirement in existing laws. I received payment after 1st July. Will there be TDS under GST?
In TDS, because the invoice has been raised before 1st July, the tax is payable under the earlier regime. Because the tax is payable under the earlier regime, the TDS also has to be done under the earlier regime if it is applicable. Under GST, there is no TDS requirement because the time of supply happened before the transition date.
My goods or capital goods are lying with my agent on 1st July. Will I get input tax credit carry forward?
Here, see, if the goods are lying with the agent and it is a purchase by me, so it was my input tax credit. But now, if the agent, after the transition date, because if he supplies the goods, the liability will come on him. So the law says that this credit should be reduced by the principal and the credit should be taken by the agent. So I'll not be eligible for ITC, the agent will be eligible for ITC.
I paid service tax in advance for work contract services, but actual supply completed after 1st July. What will be the treatment under GST?
So in this case, as per the present service tax law, the tax is payable on receipt of advance. So when I have received the advance before 1st July, I would have paid the service tax. So to that extent, I will not be required to pay GST. Meaning thereby, if the contract, let us say, was for 10 lakhs, I had received 5 lakh rupees as advance, so I would have paid service tax on 5 lakh rupees. Now remaining 5 lakhs, I will issue the invoice for entire 10 lakhs, but the point of taxation, the time of supply will arise in GST regime only to the extent of 5 lakhs. So on 5 lakhs, I will pay GST and I will not pay any GST because I have already paid service tax on 5 lakhs before 30th June.
I received inputs or input services after 1st July, but tax was paid under the existing law. Will I be eligible to avail input tax credit?
You will be eligible.
My old contracts got revised and prices have changed. What will be the treatment under GST?
Where there is a price revision, whether upward or downward, the new credit or debit note will be issued under the GST regime. So therefore, all revisions will be treated as if they are supplied in the GST regime.
Let's take our frequently asked questions on invoice making. I have not yet received my GSTN. Can I issue invoices without GSTIN? This was answered yesterday, so we can move on to the second question. Is there any set pro forma for invoice? Can it be issued in any form?
This was covered by me in my presentation that only the contents of the invoice have been mentioned in the rules. No pro forma has been prescribed. So the taxpayers are free to have any pro forma which they want as long as the prescribed contents are contained in the invoice.
Am I required to issue a tax notice or bill of supply in all cases?
This also was covered by Panthasani's presentation that where the value of supply is less than 200 rupees and the recipient is not insisting on an issue of invoice in a B2C supply, there is no need to issue a supply for a bill of or bill of supply or invoice for every supply. It can be done on a consolidated basis at the end of the day.
I am a retailer and I supply both taxable and exempt products to the same person, B2C. Am I required to issue tax invoice and bill of supply separately?
No, here also I can issue one invoice. In the same invoice, I can show taxable as well as exempt supplies separately.
Will my invoice having many different products at different tax rates be considered as a mixed supply?
It will not be a mixed supply as long as I am showing the value of individual item differently. So if I am selling three products, attracting 5, 12 or 18%, so as long as I charge different price for all three items, it will not be mixed supply. So I will, on my invoice, I will show three different line items and show the different tax rates and the different tax amount, and accordingly I will charge the tax.
Are all expenses like freight, insurance, etc. to be shown separately in the invoice?
It will depend on how the contract has been designed. If it is designed to be charged separately, then it will be shown separately in the invoice. Otherwise, it forms part of the one supply itself.
Should I make an invoice to self for reverse charge payments?
This point was covered in the presentation, that if you are receiving supplies which are subject to reverse charge under 9.3, because the goods or services are there on which the tax is to be paid by the recipient, in that case, invoice is not to be issued. But if you are receiving supplies which are from an unregistered person under 9.4, then you will be required to issue self-invoice. That too only in those cases where what I had explained, that if it, the value was more than 5,000 rupees per day from one or more persons, and only a monthly invoice is to be issued.
How do I issue invoice in case of receipt of supplies liable for reverse charge? Covered.
As sir pointed out, that if for all supplies reverse charge which are above 5,000 rupees, one consolidated invoice can be issued at the end of the month, because I am paying tax and I am taking credit on that invoice. So one consolidated invoice is enough.
If invoice is raised in June and supply was completed in July, will GST apply?
Here also, because invoice has been raised in June itself, so the liability has arisen under the earlier tax regime itself. So even though the supply is being completed in July, the time of supply or the time of sale or the time of provision of service has happened already in the earlier regime.
How will credit or debit note from unregistered supplier be reported to GSTN and input tax credit claimed for the same?
Here also it is like invoice only. So like invoice, I'm doing a self-invoicing, I'll be doing a self-credit note and debit note.
Can we move construction material to builders on delivery challan and issue tax invoice post completion of the activity?
Delivery challan is made for goods where supply is either there is no supply, or where there is supply is there but certain particulars of supplier not known. So in such cases where suppose machinery is being used, is being moved, so delivery challan will be there. But where construction material is being moved and it is being invoiced, there specific invoice should be issued.
Can I issue manual invoices? That has been answered in the presentation. That you can issue manual invoices. Let's move on. Can I continue the serial number of invoices which I have issued under the existing laws?
This is the choice of the taxpayer from what serial number they want to issue. If they want to continue the same serial number, they are they can do it. The only requirement is that the invoice post 1st July must contain the particulars which are prescribed in the rules.
Some more questions have come on social media. Rajesh Sawant has asked with the hashtag Ask Adhia. In purchase invoice, CGST is 14%, SGST is 14%, cess is 5%, levy is 4,170 per 1,000 stake charged. How do I make a bill to the consumer?
In this case, the invoice must indicate the amount of tax rate and the tax amount separately. So first you will show the value of supplies, then you'll show the CGST rate and the amount, SGST rate and the amount, and the cess. And the total will include the value and all CGST, SGST, as well as cess.
Prabhesh Kumar has asked a question. Is it mandatory to print PAN number of stock receiving dealer on tax invoice?
In the GST invoice, you have to mention the GSTIN of the recipient. So if suppose the stock transfer is the recipient of the stock transfer is, if it is interstate, then it is in the course of, it is a supply, and therefore the GSTIN of the recipient will be mentioned, not the PAN actually.
Kamlesh Changrani has asked, enlighten on procedure for a trader for taking input tax credit on SenVat credit for stocks held on 30th June.
So this was elaborately covered in the presentation. Just for the sake of clarity, I will again repeat. If the trader has the duty paying documents, he will get full credit. But if the trader, and when I say duty paying documents, including the credit transfer document which has been prescribed under Central Excise on 30th June. If the trader doesn't have any duty paying documents, then he will be eligible to avail 40% or 60% as deemed credit. 40% in those cases where the tax rate is 5 or 12%, and 60% where the rate is 18 or 28%. The credit would be allowed in the month in which the CA supply was made and when the output CGST has been paid. So you pay the CGST and you take this much credit in your electronic credit ledger in that month. And this scheme is there for 6 months. So all this pre-budget, pre-GST regime stock must be cleared by 31st of December.
One last question. Is it mandatory for composition trader to provide bill to customer? This has been reiterated many times by the secretary himself. The answer to this is no, it is not mandatory. So let's open the floor to questions now. If you have any questions, please raise your hands.
So in an e-commerce platform, the sale happened before the GST rolled out, but goods were returned. They came back after the GST was rolled out. What would be the treatment of these goods?
So when, just I would like to inform you that TCS provisions have not yet been notified and they'll be notified sometime later. And when they're notified, and then suppose this thing happens, because the law says that it is on the net value of taxable supplies. So net means what is the outward supplies minus what are the credit notes issued. So even if that good was supplied before GST, doesn't matter, because the return is happening during the GST regime, it will form part of the negative part of the net supplies.
Any other question?
Sir, suppose for a merchant exporter who is a register in a BET, not in a central excise, he has some stock which were purchased before 30th June. Now he want to export, but as per the export invoices, how do he take care of it?
Export invoice, as I had mentioned, like, in the present.
No, that is the integrated tax paid or LUT and all that condition, sir. But that he has some stocks where SENBET has already been paid.
Because he is already registered in VAT,
yes, sir.
He will have credits of VAT, he will file return under VAT, that would be transferred as SGST credit. Now, when he exports, so he will either pay on payment of IGST or he will do exports on bond. So as far as invoicing is concerned, invoice is similar, which is there in case of domestic supplies, except that he has to give a mention on the invoice that it is for export purposes. Same thing, he can take the credit if he doesn't have the duty paying documents for excise. So that credit he can either use for payment of IGST, or if he is exporting under bond, he can take refund of that credit after submission as per the refund rules, which has been laid down in Rule 96 and Rule 96A.
Is there any other question?
If turnover is less than 20 lakhs rupees, so there is no need to register with the GST. If I purchase from unregistered dealer, whether RCM is applicable?
No. RCM is applicable only where a registered person buys from an unregistered person. So below 20 lakh, if you are not registered, then it doesn't apply. But below 20 lakh also, if you have taken voluntary registration, and you are buying from unregistered person, reverse charge will apply.
Otherwise, no. Thank you.
You may be unregistered because you are dealing in exempted goods. So in that situation also, RCM will not apply. Like Ritvik has said, you should be registered for applicability of 9-4.
Invoice rule says that I have to issue. Hello. I have to issue revise once I am allotation. Gap out of sales. I will.
We'll change your mic, yes.
I repeat my question. Suppose my sale exceeded rupees 20 lakh today. I apply for registration today and I am granted registration after 10 days. After 10 days, I will have to issue revised invoices and I have also to deposit the tax. During these 10 days, I have not collected any tax. So from where I will pay tax to the government?
In this case, I became liable for registration the day I have crossed 20 lakhs. So the law says that you have to apply for registration within 30 days. So you have applied for registration. Now after 10 days when the registration is granted, it will be effective from the date of application, the date on which you have, because you have applied within 30 days of becoming liable. So now in the meanwhile, you can't issue a tax invoice because you are not registered. So when you get registered and the registration is effective from the date of application, that is the date you cross 20 lakhs, then you are allowed to issue bill of the tax invoice. If you are able to recover the tax from your customer, then you can increase the value of the supply. If he says, no, I will not give you, then the value itself would be treated as cum tax value. The valuation rules provide that if you don't recover anything over and above the invoice, over and above the amount which is shown there, then that value itself will be treated as inclusive of tax.
Please take the mic first.
You can pay out of that tax amount or you can recover from the customer.
Pass on the mic.
Sir, there's no GST on sale of liquor in the restaurant. Sir, a restaurant serves liquor. Say rupees, he charges 1,000 for the 1,000 as price of the liquor and charges rupees 100 as service charge for serving liquor. So sir, as per VAT Act, the part of service charge is still is a part of consideration for the liquor. So would service charge would apply, GST would apply on the service charges, or it would be taxed under the VAT Act?
I'll reply to that. Anything which is served as part of the restaurant bill will be subject to GST, right? So restaurant bill itself will have total GST of 18% if it is an air-conditioned restaurant or 12% if it is a non-air-conditioned. So whether liquor is served or cold drink is served or food is served, on the entire value of food bill which is there in the restaurant, including service charge, if the restaurant has charged something called service charge, again there is a confusion among people, so people should not. Whatever restaurants are putting by way of a service charge, that is not a service tax. That is something in lieu of tip. It is like a compulsory tip that restaurants are putting, you know, service charge. So on that portion also, of course, on the portion of service charge charged by the restaurant also, so the entire total bill of the restaurant on that, SGST, CGST will apply. Alcohol ki value.
Suppose I have gone to have dinner, so 500 rupees is the food bill, 1,000 rupees is the alcohol, 100 rupees is the service charge. Now total bill is 1,600 rupees. So on what I will pay GST, that is the issue, and at what rate? So like Revenue Secretary sir has just mentioned, it is either 12% or 18%. It may be 5% if he is adopting composition. So I will not touch about that 5% thing. If it is 12 or 18%, the GST would be payable on 600 rupees. 500 rupees food bill, 100 rupees service charges. On 1,000 rupees, you will charge VAT.
I'm sorry. Yeah, VAT will be separately charged in the bill on alcohol commodity. The goods of alcohol which is consumed, on that VAT will be charged in the restaurant bill. And on the remaining items of food as well as service charges, there'll be a GST. Correct, yeah, good for.
Sir, in case of car leasing, I took a car lease before July 1, but the lease continues post GST launch. Now, central excise has been paid on this car. Will I be able to get input credit for that?
Not as of now. It will be a problem. There are a lot of representations on this about transition for lease service industry. We are looking at those representations, but we are not sure how to handle this.
Yeah. Are there any other questions? Okay, I'll ask the last question then, and that is that can the consumer come to know on the bill whether he or she is getting in the bill the benefit of input tax credit?
It's a very good question. In fact, in case of restaurant, earlier whatever was charged by way of service tax, there was no input tax credit available for food items which are served. Now that input tax credit is available, so most of the restaurants would revise their menu list, you know, and the rate of rates which are charged on food item, that should be revised downwardly because of the input tax credit which is now available. And on top of that, they can charge 12% or 18% thing. So input tax credit has to be accounted for now in form of reduction in the value of supplies which they are giving.
Thank you, Mr. Adhia and Mr. Gupta and Mr. Pandey for having joined us. That's all the time that we have for you as far as today's masterclass is concerned. And we'll be joining you tomorrow live at 4:30 p.m. again. The subject tomorrow will be composition and record keeping. And do remember to tweet your questions with hashtag AskAdhia. They will be answered on this subject tomorrow at 4:30 p.m. You are watching us live on Doordarshan Network. We'll be live on Doordarshan Network tomorrow as well. And you can also watch us live on various social media handles of PIB, on Facebook, on Twitter, on YouTube as well. And also you can catch the live webcast, that is tomorrow, that is on pib.nic.in. If you still have some questions on this subject, you can log on to www.cbec.gov.in. Thank you so much for watching.